Hey everyone, I'm here with Justin Johnson. He's recently taken the GRE at home, and I know so many of you are curious about what that experience is like. So Justin has graciously offered to share a little bit about his experience, and so we're excited to have him on board. Thanks for joining us, Justin. I'd love to start with just questions around, well, why you decided to take the GRE, what your sort of grad school aspirations are.
Well, I originally scheduled to take the GRE at a testing center at the beginning of April. And the closer it got to April and March, it didn't look like it was going to go through, and they ended up closing the testing site. And they said I could reschedule for a later time. I wasn't sure when that later time would come. And so I decided, since I'd been studying for a few months, I wanted to take it now instead of wait. And so the only way I could do that was taking it at home. So that's why I took it at home, just so I'd, because I didn't want to lose all that studying and get kind of elongate my study even longer. And then I'm taking the GRE because I'm studying to be a physician assistant and get into master's somewhere. And so if I can take the GRE, I can apply to more schools.
Yeah. And are you thinking about applying for a fall 2021?
Yeah. So far, a lot of schools look like they're still going to have applications open. And at the beginning of their programs are just going to be online.
Can you share a little bit about sort of the experience in terms of, you know, how you were feeling going in? Were you feeling nervous or just fine, normal? Just getting sort of a read on what that was like for you.
Well, the weird part for me was we weren't allowed to use notebook paper. And so I had to buy a whiteboard and get used to using that for all my math problems and for getting my writing, making an outline. So that was weird. I also had to buy a webcam because my computer didn't have one. But besides that, I wasn't more nervous. If anything, I probably was more comfortable because I was at home by myself. I didn't have as much distractions in my room. There weren't like people watching me. And so, I mean, they were, but you couldn't tell from the computer. So I don't know. I've never taken a test in person, but I can only imagine I was more comfortable because I was by myself in my own space.
Okay. And the whiteboard piece is interesting. And for those who don't know, yes, you can't use regular notebook paper. You have to use like a laminated piece of paper or a whiteboard that you can erase. Is this something that you practiced ahead of time?
Yeah. So I practiced doing my math problems on the whiteboard because I'd gotten so used to using notebook paper. It took a little bit, you know, especially with the pens, because the pens can kind of, they write a little bit thicker than a pen or a pencil. And so I think it's good to do some practice problems on that beforehand.
Okay. And then you'd also shared that you need to buy a webcam because your computer didn't have one. One of the requirements I know is like showing the proctor the room, showing them sort of the details. People have asked, like, do you have to have a 360 degree webcam, or can you share more about like what that was like?
I just had a USB wired webcam, so I was able to pick it up and move it around the room. They do ask you to show the room slowly, and then they ask you to show underneath the desk as well. So I would just say to anyone that buying one of those with like a few feet of cord that can just plug in and you can just move it easily. Or I suppose if you have a laptop you're using on, just anything that allows you to move the webcam. I don't think you need a 360 degree one.
Yeah. And that's what we've heard too, that basically you can pick up your laptop and move it around the room. And you said that, you know, while people were technically watching, you didn't feel that way. Were you able to see their faces or anything, or was it just a voice? Like what was that initial sort of experience like?
Sure. So they use they're going through Proctor U, which uses a program. When you go to sign on, they'll introduce like a little chat for you and they'll be able to talk to you, but you don't really see their face. And so they'll take over your system to start the ETS programming to get you into the test. And then after that, they don't make any noise. They'll just like tell you when it's time for your break and when you're going to be done with your next section.
And when you said you start with a chat, is the chat voice or is it sort of like typing, or how are they sort of communicating with you?
You have both. So you have like a little chat box that you can type your questions into them, or you can talk to them. And so, but the only thing you can't do is you don't actually get to see them.
Okay. And then were you allowed to leave the room for breaks? You know, there's the short breaks between the sections and then the sort of the long break in the middle. And I was curious what that experience was like.
you're only allowed to leave for the long break. And so that's when I use my chance to go to the bathroom and get something to drink. Otherwise, the short breaks, you're supposed to stay in your little area and not leave camera sight.
Okay. And you weren't allowed to have anything else in the room with you, like food or anything like that, right?
I did have food and drinks with me, but they were away from me. So I had to like pick up my bookshelf and move it to the other side of the room. So just in your like general vicinity, you can't have anything near you.
So you can leave the room for the long break, not for the short breaks. In terms of like the pacing of the test, the experience was still the same in terms of writing first and then sort of a random assortment of math and verbal. Is that right?
Yeah. So yeah, you have the two writing sections and then you'll have the next five sections, one of them being a random, I believe like a research or a non-scored. I ended up having three quantitative sections and I could kind of tell which one was the one that wasn't scored because it was much harder. I think I left off like five questions I didn't answer.
Oh, that's an interesting experience. Yeah, so for those who don't know, there's two verbal sections. And if you get three, quantitative one is the experimental or research oriented. So it's interesting that you were able to sort of assess that. And you'd shared with me before how you scored. So can you share with the audience sort of how you scored?
Yeah, so the only reason I was able to know that the one section was experimental for my quantitative, I did so poorly on it, but I got a 166 in the math section. So I knew there's no way I could get that by missing five questions. And then I got a 157 in verbal and a 5.0 on the writing.
Yeah, congrats. Those are excellent scores. Yeah, the 166 in math. I mean, math is difficult. You're right that if you're leaving five questions blank, that would be not possible to score that well. Was that in line with sort of what you were hoping? You know, did you feel like happy about sort of the outcome of this?
I was. Yeah, I was hoping to get like a 310 on the minimum, and so I was really happily surprised I got over 320.
Yeah. And you'd shared that you'd been studying for a few months prior. I'm sure folks would love to hear a little bit about like what your study experience was like. You know, how did you structure your time? What did you use?
Yeah. So I studied for 3 months. I ended up buying one of the 6 months Magoosh, if I'm saying that right, subscription plans. And so my first month I spent doing all math. So I think I went through every single math question. And then I went through every one I got wrong until I had them all right. I think there's like 720 or more. So it was a lot. And after that, I focused on verbal. And then the last month was a combination of verbal, math, and writing. I would say I definitely did a lot more of the math questions, which is probably why I did better in math, I think, because I just had more practice with it.
Yeah. And that is what we recommend at Magoosh, of this idea of practice the questions and then go back to the ones you get wrong. It's definitely in line with what we recommend. Did you use any other materials? Did you use like the official books or did you try any of the official practice tests?
I think one of the areas I could have done better, I did try one of the official practice tests, and I did that about a week before my regular test. And I think if I was to go back and do it again, I would have taken it at the very beginning of my studies and then maybe the second one in the middle so I could see my progress. But I kind of just winged it for those. But they offer them for free, so there's no reason not to, honestly.
Yeah, we'll put links below the video for where you can access those. But you're right, you get two for free. And so we would recommend, like you said, you know, taking one at the beginning, taking one in the middle. There's actually three other ones that you can pay for that are also official. So no company is allowed to use official questions, Magoosh included. However, ETS does offer, like you said, two for free and then has three paid ones, which are a good way to sort of go through the experience. Yeah, and did you use any books or was it primarily just Magoosh's online resource?
I use Magoosh Online for my online resource. I used another company's note cards. And then I used, there's this one YouTube channel that has a really great structure for how to respond to the writing prompts. And that one, I think I give all my credit to my writing score for that because it was really great advice.
Cool. Yeah, I'm sure folks would love to know what it is. And we can drop a link to that too if you can share, if you do remember the name of it.
Yeah. Have you ever heard of the Greg Matt? He has like a Reddit and a YouTube channel.
Yeah.
It's GREG space Matt, M-A-T. He has tons of videos, and his ones on the step-by-step writing for analytical and issue prompts are fantastic.
Okay. Yeah, we can add a link to that as well. Well, thanks for taking the time. I'm sure, you know, folks are going to be thrilled to hear about your experience. So it sounds like overall, if I'm getting this right, you practiced with the whiteboard. That was key. That's a big difference. That's one thing we recommend. There was nothing crazy about the experience. You do need a webcam. Oh, and you needed a Windows machine, right?
Yeah. So you the things you have to download the ETS client, which has the test go for you. Then you have to get the Proctor U application so they can run the program on and monitor you on your computer. And then, you need the webcam and something to write on, I'm guessing.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. And we also have articles about that, and we'll link to the ETS resource in our articles below. But basically, you need a Windows machine. I think you can now use a Mac with Windows installed. So that's an option to should practice on that whiteboard. I think that's probably one of the biggest tips that people might overlook, because the experience is going to be different. You're right. It writes heavier. You have less space. And then it sounds like you had a quiet place to take the test, and you did well. So congrats. And I really appreciate you taking the time to chat.
Yeah, thanks. No problem.